introduction with respect to what exactly is machine learning and why is it so much in demand right now. Once we are done with the introduction of ML, we'll also start to look at Python as a programming language. So we'll study Python, keeping the focus on data science and machine learning. Right, so what exactly is machine learning is, it's, in fact, if you talk about learning, it is nothing but it's any process wherein you have a system that that improves its performance for some particular task with some from experience. So if you're talking about any human being, then if he's learning, then he's going to improve at some task, right? So if you draw a parallel for machines, then machine learning is concerned with programs written in programming languages, like in our case Python, which will automatically improve their performance based on past experience at some task T. So if you look at this particular definition, we'll come back to this now. Yeah, so the concept of learning in any machine learning system is, can we put in this particular slide here. It is nothing but improving with some experience at some task, right? You have some task that it has to perform, and we want to improve the performance of that machine learning system over some task T. So this is a very specific task. So you cannot improve the performance of any machine learning system with over multiple tasks. So here we'll only try to improve the performance of machine learning system at a very specific task, which is T, with respect to a performance measure T. That means whenever a task is being performed, we need to evaluate that, right? And when we evaluate that, we are going to get a review of how good or bad the performance is. And that will be based on some experience E. In our case, this particular experience E is the amount of data that we have, right? So when I'm talking about data science, the whole idea is to use the data that we have in order to improve the performance of a machine learning system at one task T with respect to some performance measure P. Now, coming back to why exactly is machine learning is so much in demand right now. Basically, the whole point is to automate, right? If you draw a comparison chart between human behavior and machine behavior, one important thing that stands out in humans is that they are very much error prone. That is, the probability of them making a mistake is very high. So to overcome that, and also to make sure that machines are more efficient, that is why there is a huge need for ML right now. Also, when I'm talking about ML or AI or deep learning, basically what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to mimic human behavior and intelligence over some monotonous task. Suppose we have a task where I need to extract certain keywords from a document over a period of time, like on a daily basis. So in this particular task, if I have a human being performing this task, then he's not going to be that good at it, because it is a very monotonous task, and there are chances of him going wrong, or there are chances of him committing an error. So such tasks where you don't need much decision-making ability is where ML comes into the picture. Not just there, other places also, but mostly there, where we have a lot of tasks that need to be performed over time, the same task. In that case, we can always use ML. Not just that, that is with respect to ML. When you talk about AI, then we get into decision-making. We help machines take human decisions, right? That is AI. Now, why is there so much of demand right now, and not why was it not there in the last, say, 20 years? The reason is the amount of data that's available, right? If you have gone through the web per day, I think around 2.4 trillion bytes of data are generated on a daily basis. Now, you need some sort of handling mechanism to be able to handle that data, to be able to derive conclusions from that, and to be able to sort of analyze them. So one important point why data science and ML is so much in demand right now is because of the amount of data that's available at this moment. Also, even though if you take into consideration that data existed 20 years back, but we did not have the computational power that is required. When I say computational power, I mean your GPUs, graphical processing unit, which has just started in the last maybe 5-10 years with respect to NVIDIA or Intel. So that is another case. So there is a lot of data that's available, and also you have the power to compute. So because of these two reasons, we can say that ML is very much in demand right now, and also the a lot of interest has been generated recently with respect to your researchers as well, and also the support from industries is very, very high. If you look at right now, every industry is starting to use machine learning and AI, you know, to improve their product or for better performance of their product, for a lot of other things. In fact, for every aspect of any industry, you can always use ML and AI. That's one thing. Now, if you talk about the applications in strictly machine learning and not look at AI or the other parts, these are the ones. So the ones that stand out here are, you can see image processing, computer vision, you have natural language processing. And also in healthcare, it is diagnosis. For example, I will just show you one small demo here. So I just came across this blog on LinkedIn today. What the, I mean, there is a guy called Andrew Ng, who is known as the father of deep learning. So what this guy and his team did was that they built a image detection algorithm using deep learning. It's called ChexNet. So what this does is, according to the results that they have shown, or they claim, it is proven that it performs better than even the best radiologist on the planet. So this is the kind of advancements you are seeing in healthcare and image processing. So what they did was they developed an algorithm that can detect pneumonia from chest X-rays at the level exceeding that of practicing radiologists. So what all you need to do is you need to pass your chest X-ray, and it is going to give. So what exactly is their model is that it is a 121 layer CNN. If you were here yesterday, then we discussed what is ANN, what is CNN, what is RNN. So they have used a CNN, which is basically for image processing. So that will input a chest X-ray image, and it will output the probability of pneumonia along with the heat map localizing the area of the image most indicative of pneumonia. So in this case, what it does is if you pass a simple black and white X-ray, it is going to draw a heat map like this. So if somebody smokes, you will understand the importance of this. Because I know. So here, you need to pass this black and white image, and it's going to result in an image like that. So you see that the areas that are red, right, are the most affected areas, and the chances of pneumonia are very, very high for that person in that area. So this kind of analysis, not even a doctor can do. And that is the kind of power that, and this is just the beginning. I mean, the kind of things that will, like you can see here, they are just inputting a chest X-ray image, a black and white. Your model is your 121 layer CNN, and what it outputs is a pneumonia, and it says that that person is pneumonia positive with 85% chances of pneumonia, and it also gives a heat map. When I say heat map, the color with the highest frequency is most affected. So here we can see that left bottom side of his chest is really badly affected, followed by these areas which are blue in color. I mean, blue is not maybe, but this is the most affected area. And they also did a comparison, and I'll just show you that. Yeah. So they took four radiologists and the model here, which is your chest ChexNet, and they saw that this model was performing far better than all of these radiologists combined. So you can think of F1 score as an accuracy. So as and when we start this course, you'll understand what exactly is F1 score, what is recall, all these things when we do image processing. But here we can see that your ChexNet is performing far better than all your four radiologists combined. So this was just a small example where we see that deep learning can really improve healthcare and diagnostics. So these are some of the applications. We did this. This example, I think we saw yesterday, right? We did a spam on what exactly is spam, huh? We didn't do that. I did? Okay, so I just told you. So I just revised that. So if you want a small example, or if you want a motivating example to, or why you should in fact look at machine learning, this is a very good example. If you all have your smartphones, right? So you have your Gmail built in that app. You have your Gmail app. Now, one good thing about Gmail is whenever, or one application is, whenever a new mail comes in, it is able to classify it as a spam or a ham. Or it does a spam. If a new mail comes in, it automatically is able to classify into the spam folder. Now, how is this done? Is that in the background we have a machine learning algorithm called naive bias algorithm running in the backend. Now, what this does is, it is based on your conditional probability, which is part of, I think, M4 Bayes theorem. So it uses that particular theorem to be able to classify emails based on the text present in that email into spam or a not spam sort of a mail, the respective folders. We did this in detail yesterday. So how exactly does this learning process happen? It's just a flowchart of any ML system. So we'll try to understand this. So at the left corner, we see that we have something called as the real world, right? Now this real world could be anything from where you are deriving your data. Like if I'm trying to do climate prediction, or if I'm trying to understand the pattern, weather patterns in Bangalore. So that could be your real world, the climate or the rain levels or the rainfall or sunlight levels or whatever it is. Now to capture data from the real world, you need a measuring device. Like if you want to capture the rain levels, you need a particular device, or if you want to capture sunlight, you need some other device, or if you want to any sort of data that you want to capture, you will need that sort of a device. Now coming from that data, we cannot just say straight away use this data to build the last part, which is your machine learning model. We need to do a lot of pre-processing in this. So these two steps, right? This pre-processing, dimensionality reduction, and model learning. These three form the most fundamental building blocks of any ML system. So pre-processing, dimensionality reduction. And you talk about pre-processing, you also have something called feature extraction. So we'll study each one of these steps in detail before we jump into the exact process of machine learning, but these are the three most important steps where we pre-process the data that we get from the measuring devices. We reduce the dimensions of the data, and then we build our model. Now, I cannot get into the depth of pre-processing and feature extraction and the other things because it will not make sense right now. But if you can just have an idea of how it's happening, the flow. You have the real world from which you collect the data, and then you pre-process it. That is, you make it into, you will pre-process in the sense, I am getting the data, I am converting it into a form which is suitable to be fed into this ML model, right? And then I will reduce the dimensionality in between. Like if it's a 50 dimensional data, I cannot use it, I need to reduce the dimensions. In between, we have something called feature extraction. Feature extraction is where I will try to extract the features from the data. So all these steps we'll see for every algorithm henceforth. Once the model is built, we are supposed to evaluate it. Like, you have your model that is trained, I need to evaluate it, I need to, like we saw, right? Machine learning is improving the performance of a model over some time T with respect to some performance measure P. Now this is your performance measure, wherein I try to evaluate my model and analyze the results. So this is how the whole learning process happens. So it's around a five-step process. This one works, huh? How does it? Right, so What we'll do is we'll start off with Python, because we've had I think two classes of introduction. We'll start off with Python, and we'll start gradually because we are expecting a couple more to join. So Python again will be split like we saw yesterday that so here Python itself will be split into two modules, your basic and advanced, and we'll also have a small introduction to R programming. And also the other part of prerequisites, which is mathematics, under math we have probability, PDF, probability distribution function, all two types of distributions, 2 and 3, linear algebra, quadratic, coordinate geometry and differential calculus. So this will cover the math part. So initially we'll start off with Python and we'll try to understand what exactly will we do when we study Python for specifically for data science and machine learning. So we'll start with that, then we'll have statistics. So this entire block will be covered in around 20 classes, so expect around 20 days for this. Once we're done with B0, we get into something called predictive modeling, where we will study around two types of predictive modeling algorithms, linear regression and logistic regression, and we'll also try to understand a very important topic called detecting outliers. So that is going to be your first block, B1, which would take approximately around 4 classes. Then we get into data science as a subject itself, where we'll study using two frameworks. One is it's called scikit-learn or sklearn. This is the first framework we'll use. Under this we'll have an introduction to data science, what exactly it is, what are the opportunities associated with data science. Then we move on to two libraries, one is NumPy and Pandas. I think you've seen all of this yesterday, so I'm just briefing it now. Once that is done, we will learn how to handle large data sets. We will do a lot of data extraction, analysis and visualization, and for which we will be using Matplotlib and Seaborn to visualize the data that we have. It could take around 20 classes for this. Now libraries for data science, we go for the IDE that we use is your Jupyter Notebook. So this is your IDE. These are the libraries that we will use for ML. You have NumPy, Pandas. This is for visualization, Matplotlib, Seaborn and Bokeh, and SciPy is for applied statistics. Now all of these are open source, so you don't have to spend anything on it. Next is your B3 block, wherein we will have, it's also called Applied ML. Applied ML is where I will learn how to use the statistical tools that I learned in my B2 block to be able to implement these algorithms. These are pure machine learning algorithms, starting from decision tree, random forest, naive-Bayes, Bayes theorem and KNN and K-means. So along with this, we'll also see what exactly do we mean by supervised and unsupervised. Clustering, right? We'll see what exactly this is as well. And then we have the last two algorithms, which is support vector machines, SVM, which are a class of ML algorithms, which will cover two algorithms in this. We have SVC, which is a support vector classifier, and a support vector regressor, support vector machine. We have another topic there. Next we get into something called Applied ML2, where we will learn how to, we would have studied around 10 algorithms here. What we do in B4 block is we will learn how to customize these algorithms or mix and match these algorithms in order to suit our requirement. So whenever we have a problem statement, it need not be that the problem statement can be directly solved using either SVC or your k-nearest neighbors or any one of these algorithms. It need not be the case. So what we will need is we will have to integrate two or more algorithms or use them together in ways we want in order to fit our problem statement. So that's what we will be doing in B4 block. The good part is that after each block you will have a case study also, like for ML applied ML2, you'll have a case study of something called as your recommendation engine. Now, when I talk about recommendation engine, it is nothing but if you have done online shopping, if you have bought something, the next time, say you bought something on Amazon, and next time you log in, it is going to suggest items to you, right? Or if you are looking at some product, it is going to say, people who bought this also bought. So that is exactly done by your ML algorithm called as a priori algorithm. So this is the algorithm that runs in the background of Amazon. We'll learn two such algorithms. One is a priori, and the other one is called eclat. So these two algorithms we'll learn. After which you will also have a case study where you will have to use one of these above algorithms in order to fit your new problem statement. Once that is done, we will move into something called deep learning and AI, which is the last block. So under deep learning and AI, we will see what exactly is the hype behind deep learning, and we will learn how to use your two frameworks, which is Keras and TensorFlow. We will also study basics of neural networks. Once we're done with that, we will get into the types of neural networks. So we start with MLP, which is multi-layer perceptron, ANN, which is your artificial neural network, CNN, like you saw there for chest X-ray, and also your RNN for text data. And we also have an LSTM, which is a variation of RNN, again used for long sequences of data. So what exactly am I trying to do using deep learning or ML is, I'm trying to either mimic, I can do one of the two things. I can either build an ML system that can mimic human behavior, right? I can make it do things that a normal human being is doing, automate that task. Like if you are a, what do you call it? Manual tester. So this entire process of manual testing can be easily automated in any system using machine learning. That is one thing. The other thing is you can build systems that can take decisions on its own. Like if you're trying to build a self-driving car. In that case, what this AI agent in this case, whenever you have an ML system taking decisions, it means that it is an AI agent. So basically the whole point of AI is to mimic human intelligence, not behavior, but intelligence. So it's going to take decisions that normal or a qualified or a professional human being takes, like a car driver. So if I build a self-driving car, like what your Tesla is doing, we are basically mimicking human intelligence. That is nothing but artificial intelligence. So when we move on to AI, we'll see what exactly is AI, what are AI agents, what are environments, and what is reward and reward policy. And we have a lot of other topics here, like we have something called Markov decision process, MDP, and a couple of other things. So this would take around 5 to 10 classes. Again, we will have a case study for this. That's where it gets interesting, because we will build an AI agent, or you will be building an AI agent that can play any game, going all the way from Doom, Candy Crush, or anything, and it should be able to beat any professional Candy Crush player, if there is anyone around here who plays a lot of Candy Crush. So it should be able to beat that person as well. So we have around two case studies here. One is an AI agent that can play any game. The other is we'll try to build a self-driving car, not in real life, but we will build an environment of our own, and we will deploy a car in that. And see, we'll train the car to to stop at signals, to pre-process the sign data. If it's red, it has to stop. If it's green, it has to move forward. And then we'll also teach it how to avoid obstacles, movement from left to right and all that. For which we'll be using a particular framework called OpenAI Gym. So this is what the course looks like over the next 3 months. Overall, I would be taking around 60 classes Monday to Friday. So any doubts regarding the course?